Oh, why are you broke? You should have kept playing. Stay woke. Tell the person next to you, stay woke. Matter of fact, wake them up if they were asleep during praise and worship. They may not have known what praise and worship was all about, so they may be sleeping. Stay woke is our title this morning. Good morning and welcome to Inspiration Church. If you're first time guest here, raise your hand real slow. Okay, amen. Welcome, welcome. We're glad that you are here. We're a little unconventional, but we still believe in Jesus. Amen. We may do some things a little bit different, but it's just so that we can get the message of Jesus Christ out to the masses. We're speaking a different language to a different group of people. And we know that the word of God doesn't change, but we know that the seasons do change. And how we speak into those seasons may have to be more palatable to the ears that are listening. And so when we study, we say, how can we make sure that the unbeliever, the person that's been a believer all of their life, the one that's been wayward, the one that's been in and out of church, that they can still get the message and be able to take it forth throughout the nations. Amen? Amen. And so that's what we're doing this morning. I got a scripture that we're going to read from, and it's Matthew chapter 26, 36 through 46, and that's on your program. If you don't have a program, just go ahead and raise your hand as those lights are coming on. Go ahead and raise your hand. We want to get one of those to you. I think everybody has one because you came in through that way. Hey, we are getting ready to go streaming, and so my greeting is going to change as we get ready for that. And so we know that we have followers in Germany. We know we have followers in Africa. We have followers in Los Angeles. And so we want to welcome you guys into the stream, and you guys join us all across the world. And it's been through our morning prayers and through our YouTube channel that people have been connecting with us. Another thing that we have also been able to secure is Wesleyan. I don't know if Wesleyan is in here. She's outside. She may be working. But Wesleyan was able to secure us a $10,000 grant a month from Google AdWords. So that means that we can now advertise $10,000 a month. That means that's $300 and some odd a day that are going out to show people what Inspiration Church, and we're trending all over the nation. So that's something to, y'all got to get a little bit more excited about that. I mean, the way that you get excited about this is the way people gonna get excited about you when you get your stuff. So if you can just start now and say, let me get excited about this, because I know when I get excited about this, then God's gonna do some stuff in my life, because the church, God is speaking to the church. So we're excited about that. And so she texted me last night, and she said we had over 6,000 impressions from this one ad that we just started running last week, and 419 clicks. That's history. That's history. That's more than we have ever had, because for the longest, we have been hitting on the internet. And so now that we've broken outside of those walls, God has given us the lens to be able to grow, amen, and to be able to expand into different areas. I've got a word from God for you today, and I've been excited about it. You have been sleeping, but I've been preaching to myself. And so today I pray that I can get this out into the public. This morning, as you're standing, as we get ready to read the word of God, I want you to get ready, because we're going on a roller coaster. Matter of fact, ask the person next to you and behind, ask them, are you ready? And then answer that question. Answer. You ready? Say, I'm ready. How many of y'all had some caffeine this morning? Raise your hand if you had just a little bit of caffeine. Raise your hand if you had too much caffeine this morning. Raise your hand if you didn't have any caffeine. I can tell. Y'all look like y'all sleeping in a mug. And so I'll make sure that you stay woke this morning. Matthew chapter 26, 36 through 46. If you were not here the previous 2 weeks, the first one was called, Is Jesus Sleep? Is Jesus Sleep? The second week it was, Wake Jesus Up. And this week it's called, Jesus Is Woke. Stay woke. And so as we trend through these trendy topics and these questions, I want you to ask yourself the question, is Jesus woke in my life? Say, self, is Jesus woke? And internally answer the question, not out loud, because we don't want your business to be in the street. Amen. So now, before, they were on this ship, they were on this boat, they were going to the other side. Jesus was asleep in the boat. The disciples felt like they didn't care. And so they asked Jesus, how can you sleep? Do you not care if we die? And Jesus was offended, because he's God. He came from heaven to earth to come and show the way. And he was offended about that. And so now we fast forward, and we're close to the time where Jesus is about to die. And Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, And the story starts here. It says, then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane. See if you can say that. Gethsemane. It sounds funny off the Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I go and pray over there. That's a powerful word. He told the disciples, sit here while I go where? And do what? He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, which are James and John, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Now, these three people that he just took with him, they were with him at the Mount of Transfiguration. Anybody have not heard about the Mount of Transfiguration? Okay, we got everybody. Okay, so all of y'all have heard that part. So they have experienced God in his extreme glory on the Mount of Transfiguration. He's seen all of these dead people flashing before them, and it's like, man, this is like virtual reality. And Peter was like, let's build a tent. Let's stay up here the whole time. And Jesus like, no, we got to go back down because we have to go to work. And Jesus goes into this garden. He tells nine of the disciples, no, there's 10, 11, 12, nine of the disciples to stay here. He takes three with them, and he tells them that he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. He's shown them the glory. Now he's showing them his story. And as he's looking at this story, he says, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Jesus is on the verge of death in this garden. He just came off the mountaintop. Anybody ever had that, something really good, and then it seemed like just right after that, all hell just, what is that? Why, God? Why so many extremes? And he goes to the disciples and he tells them, he says, stay here. Say, stay here and watch with me. He tells the first people to do what? Sit. And then he goes over here and he says them to stay here and do what? He went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping and said to Peter, what? Could you not watch with me for how long? How many of y'all couldn't pray for 1 hour? You went to sleep. You got woke you up. You went to sleep that one. Can you not stay up with me for 1 hour? He says, pray, watch, and pray lest you enter into temptation. This is the part this is the real deal right here. Cornell, this is the passage right here. This is the part. This is the sentence. This is the tweetable. This is the one that can convict you every day. He says that the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Say, my spirit is woke. My body is asleep. Anybody ever felt that? My spirit, I want to just go out there and I want to crusade. But then your body is telling you, my mind is telling me, okay. But my body is telling me, okay. He says, again, a second time, he went away and he prayed saying, oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done. And he came and found them asleep again. How many times does Jesus have to tell you to wake up? But I'm thankful that while the disciples were sleeping, Jesus was praying. Even yet, John and Durbin, while you were sleeping, God was yet faithful praying. And then he comes to this part and he says, so he left them, went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to his disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, say rise. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. High five somebody on your way down to your seat and tell them Jesus is woke. So tell them stay woke. Just for 1 hour. We in church for one. Just stay woke for one hour. I got a picture of my son. Some of you guys may know my family. Some of you may not. But this is coming up is my son. And his nickname is Bud. And Bud is, my wife calls him a Sour Patch Kid. because he's nice 1 minute, and then the next minute he is. Look at that smile. Look at that. I mean, he is just the cutest little thing. But Bud will get you if you mess around and betray Bud. Now Bud has a sister, and his sister, his older sister, is named Summer. And I got a picture of those two right there. These are the two we went out to the aquarium, and they both got their faces painted. And so we see that Bud is a Spider-Man, and Summer's just beautiful. She's got a butterfly on her face. Now, these two are very interesting. In the morning time, if one is up, they don't want the other one to be asleep. So what Bud will do is he'll climb down off of his bunk bed, and he'll go out, and he'll come downstairs. And if he doesn't see Summer, he'll go back upstairs, and he'll go and wake Summer up. Now, this is not good, because if you know Summer, Summer is emotionally on extremes. She can be your best friend, or she can be your worst nightmare. It's like a sweet dream, or I was just trying to see what kind of music y'all listen to. You don't want to listen to the alternative music. All right. So when Bud wakes her up before it's time, it's not good for the rest of us. Because when she comes downstairs, she's whining, and it's like, I'm trying to sleep, Sparkle trying to sleep. Oh, matter of fact, my wife is back. If y'all can give her a shout, I say, what they call you? Miss Sparkle. You are the sparkle of my eye. Matter of fact, just say, you are my sparkle. Now, it's my sparkle. I can't say he's my sparkle. That's my sparkle. No. And then that's also my newest son, Carson. He's in the thing. We got some headphones on, so he can't hear anything y'all are saying right now. But when you get a chance, take a gander at him. He's a beautiful, beautiful guy. He looks just like me. So if you don't get a chance, don't worry. You've seen him already in front of you. But Bud likes to wake Summer up. And we get upset with Bud because he wakes up everybody. So now when Carson is sleeping, and he wants to play, guess what he'll do? He'll go over to the swing and wake Carson up. Now, that's not good either. Anybody ever woke up a sleeping baby? And what they start doing next? Worst thing in the world. Bud is a terror. I love him because he's so cute, man. He's a lovable guy, but he will wake everybody up. And he wakes people up because he doesn't want to be alone. Jesus had the same issue of not wanting to be alone. Matter of fact, most of the time when Jesus prayed in the morning, he would go off by himself. But it seems like this moment, he brings the 12 disciples with him, and he drops off 9, and he takes 3 a little bit further, and then he goes a little bit further, but he gives them instructions along the way. The first instruction that we see, if y'all like my new little program, just give me a thumbs up. Trying to do a little something. These are my little memes here, trying to stay cool, relevant. The first one, it says to sit here while I go and pray over there. Say, sit here while I go and pray over there. They had never been with Jesus when he was going off into this place by himself to pray. But they're along the ride. And all he tells them to do what? While I go do what? He says, sit here while I go over here and pray. Anybody ever felt like you were just useless? Like why am I here? Like, why am I here? Matter of fact, has God ever positioned you in a place where you're at a job or you're in a relationship and you wake up one morning, you say, why am I here? Like, why? Why am I in this place? Why, miscellaneous, am I at Hightower? Why am I here? Why am I just sitting here when I feel like there's so much more for me to do, but I know that God has me here? And anybody ever felt that way? As a matter of fact, is anybody in that position right now? Like, I'm in a position right now, and I'm wondering why I am here. And Jesus gives them instructions to sit here while he goes to pray. Who taught you how to pray? Answer that question, not a rhetorical question. Grandparents? Church? Anybody got a different story? Well, do you know how to pray? Who doesn't know how to pray? Raise your hand. Okay, all right. All right, cool. So prayer, one of these things that we've heard before, we said there's power in prayer, right? So that there means there's something powerful with this prayer. Prayer, in the simplest form, we call it communication with God, right? And most of the time when we pray, who does all of the talking? We do, because we got some stuff we got to get off of our chest, and we need to handle that. And so he tells them, he says, sit here while I go over there and I pray. Now, I was wondering, like, why would Jesus, this is God in human form coming down to earth, and he is taking these disciples with him, and he tells them to sit here while I go over there to pray. It was baffling to me, and I was wrestling with it all week, and I was like, why is he telling them to sit here while he goes to pray? And then I thought about the boat, because when they were up, he was sleeping. Now he's awake, Jesus woke, and he's telling them, hey, come with me, but I want you to sit here while I go and pray. And he's telling them to sit here because he's saying, as you sit here, I'm going to go work and fight a battle for you, but I need you to be in the midst. But sometimes we don't know what battles need to be fought when everything around us is going well. So much to the point that when they could see terror, they needed Jesus. But when they couldn't see terror, they was going to sleep. Can I submit to you right now that the same Savior that the Israelites were looking for in the New Testament for the reasons that they wanted Jesus is very different from today? Because the Israelites, the Jews, the people that were looking for the Savior, they were looking for somebody to overthrow the Roman government. There's this government in place that's oppressing the people, and they are saying, I'm looking for a way out because we want to be able to have our own thing, and they're looking for the Savior to come and to overthrow these particular people. Today, we are not looking for somebody to come and overthrow President Trump. Well, some of us are. But it's not our intention of being in an oppressed situation. Matter of fact, how many of y'all are physically oppressed this morning? Look around. Look around. Take a gander. Nobody hand is up. Because when we are not oppressed, that gives us indication and a position to go to sleep. Because when we're not physically tormented, Michael, our prayer lives fail. How many can attest to that? Yeah. It's not until things get bad that you come back to church. Matter of fact, when things are going really bad, you don't miss church. But when everything is cool and the money's coming in and everybody's fine, guess where you at on Sunday morning? Sleep. And Jesus is telling the disciples, I need you to come with me because I'm about to go intercede for you on my behalf because there's some stuff that's happening that you can't see. There's some stuff that's happening that you have no visual sight of, and I'm about to go see it in the spirit. Matter of fact, write this down in your notes. Prayer is our way to see into the spiritual realm. Prayer is our way to see into the spiritual realm. Prayer is our way to see into the spiritual realm. And so this little meme says, why do I just sit here? Because when Jesus tells you to sit, he's going to work on your behalf. When he tells you to sit, he's going to work. Tell it to the person and say, when he tells you to sit, he's about to go to work. When you go to the movies, what do? While the movie plays, when he tells you to sit, he's putting you in a position to watch him work. Matter of fact, if you don't believe me, as we go down a little bit further, he says that he began to be distressed, and he said to the three disciples, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. He tells them to stay here and watch with me. Sit here and watch. I'm going to go pray, but I need you to watch. He was telling them to watch because they just watched him on the Mount of Transfiguration. All of this great stuff happened, but he says, I need you to see me how I struggle. I want you to see me in pain. I want you to see me fight with these demons that are trying to take me out. I want you to see me fight with Satan. They're trying to kill me in the garden. I want you to see how I fight. And the way that he fights is he goes into prayer. Say, I can fight when I pray. Yeah, the enemy would even try to stop you from praying. Anybody ever woke up in the middle of the night and was trying to pray, but you kept going to sleep? That's not a physical battle. You understand that? That's spiritual warfare. That's spiritual warfare. If God is waking you, anybody got woke up in the last week early in the morning? Like, you don't know why you was up. And when you get up in that morning like that, what should you be doing? Praying. But it seems like sometimes when you try to pray in that comfortable position, what happens? You go back to sleep. It's one thing to sit back and watch God fight your battles for you, but it's another thing when he gives you instructions. He tells them to do what? Sit and watch. Meaning, if he's telling them to watch Noel, if he's telling them to watch Mark, he's about to show them something. Now, when Jesus says watch, you know the song, "Don't Believe Me, Just Watch"? When he's telling them to watch, he's really about to do something that's powerful. But they couldn't watch because they kept going to sleep. How many of you are trying to see what God is doing? I'm trying to watch. May I submit to you that if you spend more time in prayer, that he can show you what he's doing? You can't see what God is doing because you are distracted by many things. You're distracted by your schedules. You're distracted by your own plans and your own positions. You're distracted by all of the calamity that's going around in your life. And he's telling you, I need you to watch. Sit here, stay here, and watch. He says he went a little bit further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Jesus is fighting in this moment for his life. Now, there are two ways that theologians have looked at this passage. They've looked at it, one, that Jesus does not want to go on the cross. The other thing is that Jesus is sick and is fighting for his life in this garden. Anybody know why it would be a shame if Jesus died in the garden? Who knows that answer? A couple of people. If Jesus dies in the garden, say that with me. Say, if Jesus dies, he can't bear the sins of the world. If he doesn't make it to the cross, him coming down from heaven to earth is a sham. If he dies, he no longer can be crucified by the people that he came to die for. And if he dies there, the plan of God in salvation that he started even in the book of Genesis is wiped away. And so Jesus is saying, I am about to die and I need to make it to that cross for your sake. Because if I don't go to the cross for your sake, then there's no way for you to be sin free. My blood does not shed, it does not cleanse, it does not wipe everything away. If I die with these blood dripping down out of my face, my blood is not shed for you, it's shed because of this sickness. And he's saying, I need you to stay up and I need you to watch me as I battle for my life so that I can die. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Jesus needed to die, but not in that moment. Matter of fact, I don't even understand how the personification of this God image, this man who is God in human form, needs other people to pray. Why? Matter of fact, how many of y'all see God as like Jesus, like a superhero? Anybody see Jesus as a superhero? Nobody sees him. I kind of see him as a superhero in my mind. Sometimes when I think about Jesus, I think that he knows everything that's happening before it happens. Right? Like people are about to die. And he like just go intercede for the people that are about to die. But you know what? That's not really what happens. Matter of fact, the only time that Jesus works is when he's called upon. Right? You think about that? Until he's called upon, Jesus isn't, he's not going around stopping everything from happening. Oh, you about to get into an accident? Oh, I saw that coming already. No, it's only when they call on the name of Jesus that he goes to work. And so Jesus understands that in order for my power to be made perfect, in order for my power to be activated, I need to go to the Father in prayer. Prayer is his activation key card into heaven. Even Jesus had to pray to get connected to God. so that he could have life. And he's talking to himself, but he's talking to himself in heaven. And he's saying, if it is your will, let this cup pass. Jesus is fighting for his life. Anybody ever been in a fight for your life? If you haven't, praise God. Matter of fact, clap if you never had to fight for your life. Clap. Give God some praise. Oh, no, that's a patty cake. That's a golf clap. Like, if you've never had to fight, because that means that somebody has already fought the battle for you. Matter of fact, the disciples were able to sleep because Jesus was fighting for them. Matter of fact, the only reason that you can get rest is because God has already gone before you to make provision for what you're going through and what you're about to face. Jesus is saying that I'm fighting for you now because in the future, you're going to need somebody with victory, and I'm going to go fight on your behalf now for the problems that you have not even faced yet. When we can understand that God is already working 10 steps ahead of us and he's telling us to walk by faith, that means that our whole concept of who God is has to change into a mindset of knowing that if Jesus is woke, I don't have to worry about what's happening to me right now because God has already made provision for me now. So the relationship that I'm struggling with, the financial struggle that I'm having, this bid that I'm having between myself and my thoughts and my mind and my self-esteem and my anxiety and this friction that I'm having because I don't have any peace and I can't get along with my baby mama or baby daddy or my wife or my husband or my ex-girlfriend, I can't get it. God is saying that I'm already prayed on your behalf in the garden that he says this. He says, matter of fact, you need to pray lest you fall into temptation. So then the question is, if Jesus is praying so hard, should I be watching him or should I join him in prayer? He tells them to sit, stay, and then he tells them to pray lest you fall into temptation. But before that, he tells them to stay woke. Say this, say stay woke. And pray lest you fall into temptation. Woke. What does woke mean? Woke means to be alert to the injustice in society. How many of y'all follow politics at all? Anybody follow politics? Trump right now is having a battle with who on Twitter? Yeah, and what did he tell? He told them, if they don't like this country, they can do what? Go back to it. That is so terrible. But the same time that he's going into a Twitter war, did y'all see about the $100 billion contract that he signed to help the black communities? Did y'all see that as well? Oh, y'all didn't see that part. In the same moment, we see him being extreme racist, at the same moment making huge deals for the community that we think that he may be racist again. Stay woke. Because if we're not careful, we will fall into temptation and we'll follow every rabbit trail that's been pitched to us. Let me submit to you this. Another thing that Trump and administration has done is they are now giving out grants and loans for churches to build churches in rural areas. They will give grants as long as your church is utilized as some sort of community place where either firemen can meet or the police can meet or somebody can meet. He's giving out money for that. The government is doing that right now. So guess who gets the benefit from that? You're the only one caught that. Guess who gets the benefit from that? We do. Forget the we get to benefit from that. And so it's like when God is setting things up, we have to stay. Because if not, we can get bogged down into the silly stuff. Matter of fact, if your social media is set for silly stuff, guess what you're going to see? Because what you look at is what they're going to feed. Matter of fact, in life, what you see is what you're going to see all the time. And so Jesus is giving them a different picture of what they've seen him do. They've seen him heal. They've seen him raise the dead. They've seen him do all of this stuff. But he says, I need you to see me struggle because you too will have struggles. But take heart because I'm about to overcome the world. So you can see me in my glory, but I need you to see me in my story. Because when you start to go through your pains and afflictions, I need you to wake up and pray. lest you fall into temptation. Stay woke, lest you fall into temptation. And so now when I'm asking God, what is it that I should be praying for? Some of us don't know what to pray for, but the scripture says when you don't know what to pray for, start to speak and pray in the spirit and start to speak in tongues. And he says, when you don't know what you're praying for, I'll give you words to pray. And as you pray those things, I will start to work on your behalf. The more that we pray, the more our minds will be clear and he can show us the other side. This is what is so shocking to me, is that when Jesus goes back to the disciples the last time, he says, are you still sleeping? After he tells them, are you still sleeping? He tells them to arise. The betrayer, my betrayer, is at hand. Jesus, in his moment of prayer, sees who's in his inner circle. That's powerful stuff for me. Because I want to know what my relationship is with the people that I have the closest to me. I don't want to have to go around and worry if this new business person or this new deal that I'm about to make, if this person is shady or not. It's in prayer that Jesus finds out and knows that Judas is already about to sell him out. But this is how Jesus handles his haters. He doesn't go off the mountain and call Judas out, does he? No. Matter of fact, he goes and he prepares a table before his enemies. And he's sitting at this table and he doesn't say, pass this cup around and pass this bread around in order and skip over Judas. He gives even Judas the cup and the bread. And he tells them, when you do this in. He knows that he's about to sell him out. But Jesus knows that it doesn't matter what he's about to do, it's all a part of God's plan. May I submit to you that your haters have been positioned for your glory? That the people that have been trying to set you uptown, the people that are trying to sabotage you, the people that are trying to ruin you have been set in place because you need them in order to get to the place that you're trying to go. Without your haters, he will not have full glory in your story. Without the lack, without the backbiting, without the emotional stress, you will never be able to see the full story of who God is in your life. You think that struggle that you're having with that boy, with that girl, is for naught. That's on purpose, because when God delivers you and he shows you, he is going to allow you to come back from the dead and to show people, yep, they cussed me out. Yep, she cheated on me. Yep, they did me wrong. Yep, they stole from me. But still, here I stand with life and life more abundantly. So now in my struggle, I'm not just facing my struggle or forcing myself to wake up and get out of bed. I'm praying without ceasing. He tells us to pray without ceasing because he said there's always going to be something going on. Will you be tuned into it is the question. Will I be able to see what God is doing? Because once I pray, God is going to show me on the movie screen what's happening in my life. I'm going to tell you like this. The more time that you see him spend in prayer, God will map out your whole day. He'll show you what you're going to see before you see it. And he'll prepare you in that moment. Just like he was preparing Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, he was making things straight. He was moving things out of the way. He was setting up the table. He was preparing the table for the enemies. He was getting the guards in air. He was getting the 20, 30 pieces of silver that was about to sell him out. While he was working, Jesus had saw all of that. Even in his blood, sweat, and tears, he was praying. God was just showing him everything. And he was praying it out and saying, God, if this is your will, let it be done. He saw Judas selling him out. He saw him kissing him on the face. He saw Peter just selling him out, saying, I don't know who he is. He saw all of it, but went back to him, said, hey, guys, let's go. For my betrayer is at hand. That's some real power. That's some real power to know that people may mean harm for me, but God meant it for good. Guys, the wrestle is not against flesh and blood. That's the trick. And that's the trick to fall into temptation when you think that the enemy is your wife or your husband. That's the trick of the enemy. When you think that the enemy is your boss, that's a trick. He's saying, Stay awake and pray, lest you fall into temptation. Because the reality of is that God does not tempt us. Who tempts us? Satan. Tell that, that's theologically sound. God will test us, but he will not tempt us. And if we fall into temptation, that's why Jesus died. Because he knew that they would fall into temptation. But he says, I will always provide you a way of escape. That even you fail, I made it through the garden so that you can get back up. The Bible says that a righteous man, he may fall 7. He's completing the fall so that you may arise and be able to walk and follow in the mighty will of God. And so when we think about real action shifts, he's saying, I need you to stay awake. Now, when we say stay woke, it means to stay awake to the political climate, right? Whatever's happening, they're probably doing something behind that, right? So, oh, yeah, he gave $100 billion to that. We probably gave $600 billion to the white people. I mean, it's all types of things that you'll have coercions and these diversions and all of these things that'll make your mind go off. But the Bible tells us to dwell on these things, everything that is good, everything that is pure, everything that is holy. Dwell on these things, because when you dwell on those things, you're awakening in the Spirit. Jesus saw what they were going to do. He saw what they were going to do. He knew what they were going to do. But guess what? He was focused on the finish line. And the finish line was the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, if you suffer with me, if you die with me, then you will also partake in my glory. If you run this race with me, then you will also be awake with my glory. I don't know about you, but I want to walk with God in his glory, and I'm okay with going with Jesus Christ through the story. Because in the garden, he showed us how we should be traveling this way. He says, I don't need you to be asleep right now. I don't need you to be focused on everything and every wind and doctrine and everything that's happening in the news. I need you to stay awake and pray lest you fall into temptation. The hardest thing for us to do is to pray continuously for God to show us what he's doing in our life. The most important thing in your relationships, Monica, is prayer. The most important thing, Deshanna, the most important thing that you can do is pray. Because it's in prayer that God reveals things to us, and he gives us strength to be able to endure all things and hope all things and to be able to change things and be able to see what God is doing. When we call on the name of Jesus, he will change things. He'll change your attitude. He'll change your focus. He'll change your position. He'll change it all. And so he tells them to sit here, stay here, but I need you to also pray right here in this moment. Matter of fact, do that for yourself. Matter of fact, as you're sitting, sit there. Stay there. I just want you to pray. Just pray. If you don't even know what to pray for, just say, God, I don't know. I don't know what to pray for. I don't know where I am, but I want your direction. I need you to work with me. I need you to work through me, because it's hard for me to have a real action ship, a real relationship, if I don't know what you're doing. Because I don't know who's for me. I don't know who's against me, but I know that the battle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against principalities, rulers in darkened places that are around me. God, I don't want to fall into temptation when I leave this place, but I want to stay woke. I'm asleep in some areas of my life because you've blessed me. But I want to see into the other side. Order my steps, Lord, so that I'm not just doing stuff, going from job to job, going from house to house, apartment to apartment, getting this and getting that. Father, show me my struggles before I get there, so that I can have faith to hope in all things. Show me right now, God, if I have a purpose that's global. That if I'm supposed to go to Venezuela and help with the food shortage, show me. If I'm supposed to go to where there's water crisis and help build wells, show me. If I'm supposed to go into the schools to be able to help troubled youth, show me. Father, I want to walk in your story. Whether it's a struggle or not, I want to walk with you. Because I know that as long as I'm walking with you, Father, I'm walking in faith. And I know that the only end thing that I will see is victory. Even in my divorce, Father, show me how to walk. Father, even in the turmoil in my house and with my body and with my health, God, I'm afflicted in different areas, God. I feel like you when you were sweating blood. I didn't know exactly what was going on or how to get through, but I want you to show me. Father, if you've blessed me with more and you've blessed me with more than I can think or ask, God, show me. God, I'm struggling with my bills and I'm struggling with even having a peace of mind, but I need you to show me. Because I know that when I call upon you and I press upon you, Father, as I engage in you, Father, as I'm pushing on you and pressing on you, Father, for my life, that my life depends on you being awake, Father, I need you to be woke. Show me. So that when I finish praying and I rise up, I'll be able to get those same people that didn't mean good for me and tell them to say, let's go. We've got work to do. Father, I thank you, Father, that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. I'm praying for my spiritual life to increase today so that I may be able to see forward and watch what God is going to do. God, I want to spend more time in prayer than I've ever spent so that I can walk in your anointing to grow up. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Stay woke.